I'm back live again. While I was in my meeting, I figured some shit out.
I got it working, kind of. I still have to figure out an offset value that I don't know how to quite figure out yet, but, like, the broadly, I figured out why it wasn't updating. I figured out how to at least get it moderately functional. It's not exactly the way that I would have wanted to do it, but it does work by respawning the starfield every time. And now what I need is we can do, wait, so negative divided by negative always be positive. Divided by the absolute value gets you, or is there like a sign? Sign, perfect. Zero if it's zero, one if it's one. Perfect, perfect, perfect. That's exactly what we want. Sign. Okay, we need these three. We need the ABS. I think this is how we compute our offset. Okay, we got absolute values and signs. Then we want to, from each of these, we want to subtract our distance increment. I really have to, when this all works, I'm going to have to spend a long time on this one just making everything look good. So the idea here is when we rehome our origin, we want to figure out how much we overflowed it by, because otherwise we get like jitters. Here's this. Multiply. Now, whatever we end up with, we want it to go back to whatever the sign it was before. And now we can bring this over to right here, perhaps. McFec. And then try feeding that here. Let's try it. Still not right. I think I'm gonna have to set, this is not at the right point in time is the issue here. So what actually needs to happen is this needs to move down to right here. Before we print anything out, create a private variable. Overflow offset, and we're gonna do this set. We'll start printing that instead. And then connect it here. Let's see.
so close. Something's still going wrong there. Does it need to be flipped, perhaps? Make literal float -1 and use that to flip this, perhaps? And now, instead of hooking it up right here, we could hook it up here and give that a shot. That made it worse with the negative. Give that a shot. Everything moves back. All right, let's gas it. Hold on. Something wrong there. It's not Starfield distance, it's universe units, I think. This is distance. Yeah, it's universe units. That's why I was seeing weirdness there. Alright, take the pile. Let's try that. It's certainly closer. Now let's try spawning it in with the offset instead of moving it. It's so close. After I destroy the first one. Y is wrong. Right? X is right, but Y is wrong. Minus scene unit, scene universe unit. Oh, wait, hang on. Oops. Okay, this is an issue. Max was 0. We only want the offset on the overflow, I think. Wrong. Everybody's wrong. Here, do this. Pull this here. And then we need min here. Nope, not minus. Min. We only want absolute values that are greater than 0. Shit, these are maxes. Max. No. There we go. Multiply it 2 to avoid the frame skip. Now I bet these axes will start working correctly as well. Because that was the issue with them earlier. Was that overflow not working properly? So what if I... It's a crazy idea. First one can always just be 0, 0. I want to try this. Multiply. Equal to float. And what happens if I multiply the momentum by 2, since that would be like basically my frame overflow. So multiplying it by 2 would set you where you would be on the next frame. If only there wasn't this weird behavior. Multiply by 3. I just want to see what happens when I start doing this. And figure out if I'm on the right track. I mean, we at the very least have an infinite star field here. Or not infinite, but a universe-sized star field. If I don't rehome the origin, what happens? Oh god. It doesn't like that. Which makes sense.
Let's think about this.
multiply it by 10. What happens then? Just want to see that relationship between this number and the behavior that we want to deal with. Point back more. So was I right about this needing to be negated? Negatus. Negatus maximus. Okay, go. What's the difference? Is it just this? I think if you ignore the flickering, that's actually correct. Doesn't look like anything's moving. Well, maybe I take it back. Alright, so I'm tracking this blue sphere with my finger. I was definitely wrong. It's because the overflow Okay, I got it. It's a blend of the two. It's because the overflow is in world units and it needs to be transformed. It needs to be transformed somehow here. So this is right, except for this is probably just one. But then this unit. Here and here to convert it. Here, and this should take the actual location overflow value and convert it into, I don't know if this could work or not. Let's try it. Ooh. reorgs are always zero in that methodology. It's wrong. Maybe I'm wrong. Oh. Hang on.
Try that.
Something is turning it all to zero, probably here somewhere. Divided by... So we just take this vector, divide it by this, and multiply it by this, and then set our value, maybe. Sign will also work here. Could have also just done this, would have been better. That's how we'll negate it. Negato. All right, so next question. Let's figure out once and for all, what is the right direction? Negative 100. Negative 10,000. Negative 1,000. This should be a ward shift. What's gonna happen to this green star? Okay, it goes way back, so that's wrong. Now, what if I do positive 1,000? It's definitely narrowing the gap. I just don't understand why it's so arbitrarily. I want to see it jump forward. Like, I want to see it jump behind me to know that I'm altering the right thing. It's like, that doesn't even seem like it really did anything. Can't be right. Oh. Oh my god. Make literal float. Now I have to do all my tests again because I was on doofus mode. May 1. May 100. Let's test. All right, backwards or forwards? Backwards. Definitely snapping back. So let's try positive. Make it 1,000,000. I want to see motion, no matter what. Hey, buddy.
Hey. Hey, friend. What you doing, bub? Hey. You're a good boy. You a good old boy, yeah?
What you doing, dude? Another idea. Ooh. Good idea. Okay.
Hey there, dude.
I can spawn the new star field way off
too far away to see it. Then, yeah, let's try that.
If I take this away now, does it still work? Just out of curiosity, now that I have a bunch of other shit worked out. Function. Instead of this here, we'll just do this here. Let's get rid of that. This should be fun. Let's try it without destroying the other component. Okay. So what we want to do. Take all this logic. Let's get rid of this for the moment. actually just get this. Get this. Universe sim game instance. Are good to go. Actually, need a location but not rotation. So, here's how this is going to work. Thinking. So maybe I can just do it like this. Maybe I don't need the second one. This component, then set it as the new one. Get rid of this. Maybe it's just that simple. I don't think it is. Doesn't like that. another idea I just had. Overflow offset, what if I incorporated this here? And get rid of all this bullshit with multiplying it by a billion. Multiply it by one. See if that doesn't do anything. -1. I think that was more. Seemed like more to me. 2 or 3 to make a difference. So we have to figure out how many frames were delayed, basically. Let's say it's 5 frames. Calculate like a difference. I want to see some form of discernible difference. It's too discernible. Take it down to 1,000, or 500. I need to be able to maintain context on what I'm looking at, though. So there's a yellow. Snap. Is that the same yellow right there? Too much. some point I'm going to have to figure out how to do this by dynamically updating one instead of swapping out two. Alright, let's see what kind of numbers we get when I do one like this. We got 1800 offset, so if I change it to use this, is it still 1800? I think it might be. Or 1800-ish. No, it's not. Trial and error to figure out how the math works. It's usually not the best approach, but I don't know what else to do. I feel like if I'm going positive, I'm going negative. Okay. Now I'm going positive. My assumption was that at some point I would see the reverse motion, right? Like I do this and it jumps past me. I may have achieved it here. There's one. Oh shit, you know. I just realized. So let's start it. I'm gonna hold shift, press forward. How much is my first? Okay, 3622. 3622. Definitely is different. I'm gonna look at that that guide I looked at again, cause he talked about doing something similar. Hold up. Damn, this is tough. I'm
I'm thinking.
I mean, none of this is usable, but it is helping me figure out the math. I have to figure out how to dynamically
dynamically update particle array Niagara. I need to figure out how to. The other option We could also calculate the offset and add it here at calculation time. It would probably be minus player offset. And we can save that, compile it, go back over here.
divided by this. Physically alter the we figured it out. Maybe not. Man, I thought for a second I had it. It worked that first time, and then it stops. Why is it working that first time? There's no way that's 103, 14, 13, 122. It's definitely wrong. Camera location.
I didn't undo. I see. So we do want this. Do this. Nope, not going to this website. Niagara data interface. Go.
Hello and welcome to the Games Dev Outpost. In this video, we're going to...
Data interface. I'm just gonna have to learn, I think. I need to be able to do all this, like, figuring out the math is good. I need to be able to do all this. Inside one. Inside one,
One Niagara system is basically what I want.
Today, we're going to analyze the performance of the rune effect we created in this video using Niagara.
No. Don't need that yet. Export date, okay. Starting to retrieve a Niagara int array from a blueprint while I came across git int 32. It is not, for some reason, try to use a user exposed parameter. When I try to get a system or emitter, it does not return the valid array. My question is it possible to retrieve system and pass them to a blueprint? How we do this? Niagara events might be something that I could look into.
This is what we have. So let's go and make our just drop it on our map set. Let's access. Let's get access to our engine. Delta time, and let's get our particles velocity, which should be rotate our.
Okay, I need to see what he's in.
Second, we're gonna set render these out as some spheres. All right, so this is what we have. So let's go and make our particle. A spawn module, so event emitter.
Ah,
particle spawn. Let's add flags.
Ah, I think I found it. I think I found the thing I need.
Bleak.
Niagara dynamic input. I swear to God, with this stuff, 90% of the effort is just figuring out what exactly you need to Google.
In this video, we're going to be talking about Niagara dynamic inputs in Unreal 4.
This is what it's going to be.
Started, we'll right-click on our content browser.
I can already tell you. I bet this is
Niagara
it.
Emitter, and then we're going to go from a template, and we're going to choose the upward mesh burst. And the naming conventions, we'll name it any. Whatever you want, and then open it up. So far, we know a little bit about the modules, and within each module, we have different variables that we can adjust. For example, in the spawn burst, we have an integer, and we have a float.
Yeah, no shit.
Scale color, we have a vector 3. Initialize particle, we have sprite size, which is a vector 2. And then we also have color, which is a vector 4.
I guess I could just...
color vector 4. Now, this is notable because next to each variable, we have a dropdown. In that dropdown, we can go to dynamic inputs. When you click on that, you see a big list of options. Basically, these are ways that you can make dynamic operations. For example, if we click on add integer, we can do 10 plus 20. That's how many we want to spawn. What's even cooler is, within A and B, next to these variables, we still have that dropdown. So we can nest these dynamic operations.
Yeah.
So I can choose something like uniformed ranged int. Basically, this is an operation that says, I'm going to choose between a minimum and a maximum. So we can do either 10 plus 10, or we can do 10 plus 50.
This will be...
And the next thing to note here is, it's really important to think about where you're trying to do these. If you think back to the introduction to Niagara video, different things are achievable within each category. So in particle spawn under initialized particle, if we go to mesh scale, and we click on this dropdown, go to dynamic inputs, we can choose break vector. We're gonna set the Y and the Z to 1. And then in X, we're gonna go
custom dynamic input.
Something like
do. I could maybe just make it Wait. There, it might be even better than that. System overview, emitter update, particle update. Niagara custom. It might be emitter update. System update. Update group. Yeah, this is like, I'm just basically in a scenario where I have to learn stuff. That's fine, though.
Hello and welcome to the Game Dev Outpost. In this Niagara video, different things are achievable within each category.
Dynamic inputs. Oh shit. Okay.
Update Niagara system when user variables change.
All right, so I go back. So maybe not. Scratch pad. And updating emitters via blueprints. Okay, this is what I was looking for.
Hello, and welcome to part two of my Intro to Niagara tutorial video series. So this video is directly following up on the first video that I made about the introduction to concepts in Niagara and also creating a very basic water drop particle system, which you can see here going on right here, dropping off the surface. We're actually going to be building on that system, and I'm going to be using all of the concepts that I explained in the previous video. I'm not going to be re-explaining them. I'm going to be we're going to change the color to 0 on red, 1 on green more often. That way, as opposed to just good enough for this for now. I think we have changed everything that we want to change in here. For the time being. You see, we just have this very simple.
Yeah, but I want to see you update it via blueprint, dude.
Same name, user kill for offset. And then we're going to take our variable here, our user kill for offset variable that we made, and we're going to plug that in here. So this value is being set as whatever this kill floor offset is, which starts off at 0, as you can see. But, if we compile and save, we're going to get rid of this loose particle system we have, and we're going to drop our newly made blueprint actor into the world. So we want to get this kind of centered. There we go. So you can see it's got this little 3D widget right here, and you can click on that, and then you can transform that widget. So you can then drop this all the way down to the floor. So it's halfway in the floor. Now, I have done something terribly wrong. All right, so I just had a brain fart, and I figured out exactly what I was doing wrong, which was that I hadn't done anything wrong. I just forgot that we're looking at this in editor, not simulating or playing, and I set up the and click on this, and like I was doing before, we can change this offset so we can actually.
I guess I could do I'm gonna try putting spawn time 0. What happens if I do that? Doesn't work. Seems like I'd have to figure it out. So let's CPU save it back to where it was at. Okay. What else did I change here? Spawn time Ooh, that's a good idea. Oh, I just had a good idea. Okay, so when I get all this stuff worked out, what I'll do is I'll just carry around a star, my default star object with the visibility off. I'll make the star derive all of the parameters it needs to render from the particles instead of the randomized shit. And then I will feed the nearest particle into the star for its location and its color and shit information, because we can get mass, size, all the colors, everything we would need for stars we can get from that. And then we can just have a transition where once you get within a certain range of a particle, you move it on top of it and then start scaling it up. I'm going to make a note of that in Notepad, because that's the way to do it. Okay, so carry around invisible star in your pocket. In approach particle, move star to particle, begin scale up transition. All right, so we're back to everything at least working. We go back in here, we go here. Close this, do not save it. Okay, now we can reopen it. Here it is. Infinite. I really, like, it's so frustrating because all I really want to know, like, I could, if I could see the code, I could probably do it, is I want to make a thing so that when the sets on these variables get called, or how about specifically star count gets called, it will reinitialize everything. That's all I need. Oh, frustrating. Hmm. save. A puzzle. I realize this is just me pondering, but properties, why can't I add okay. Oh shit, my brain is expanding.
trigger. Think. Closest. I think I might understand. Okay, hold up.
Let's undo that. See if it's actually updating. It is. No. This is weak sauce. I'm looking for real shit. Research. Find closest.
creating a new empty system. Create a new asset from this, which will generate my new emitter. Creating modules has been made much more easy as well. Now, instead of right-clicking the content browser, going to effects, we can now do this directly inside the emitter or the system. This is called Scratchpad, and we can do this just by clicking the plus button next to any of the elements where we want to add it. So in this instance, I want to add it at the particle update level, and I want to create a new vector, which will be an input, and I'm going to add this to physics force, set that to transient, and get physics force, add these two together, and plug it in. Now I've created a very simple Scratch module. If we're happy with this particular module, we can actually promote it to a fully fledged module. Just right click, create asset, and then choose the location. Now we have a standalone object in our scene that we can work with. Variables have now got a color-coded tag to each one, so you can see system, emitter, and particles. If we create a new Scratch module, we can press add on map get and open up all of these variable types. Particles under common particle attributes lists all of the common particles that you're likely to access. Inputs are variables that can be set by the user, and then we have access to the engine constants as well that we can get. We don't have to just rely on these though. We can convert these variables as well. Right click, change namespace, and set to the variable you want to use. You can probably tell what system, emitter, particles do, but local, output, and transient might be new to you. Local variables are only accessible by the current module that you're working in. These are really useful for breaking up your module into smaller chunks. If we open up a pre-existing variable, you can see that they're broken up into these sections here. You'll notice that variables are being set to local and then accessed again later on. This allows you to do small chunks of maths, which you can then access again when you need. Then we have output and transient. These variables can be written to and accessed from any module. So if we have the particles update here, we can access these at any point along here, but they aren't persistent and they don't get exposed to the parameters variable. As an example, here's curl noise force. You can see it's
and this should take us back to actually traveling again. All right, hold up. There are some things we can figure out here. Because some of our math is clearly wrong no matter what. So if I go up... Am I changing just position? Or is it like flipping axes? I'm looking at this green star. Ooh, what just happened? Looking at this green-blue star on my right here. Okay, I want to start off, hang on. Start it off just like this so that we can test each one. So going pure y-axis. You got zipped back again. Yep, okay. Y-axis appears to work in the positive direction without flipping shit around. Let's check negative. So we know we're at least heading in the right direction, basically. Okay. Satisfied. We know forward and backwards work, so it's got to be z-axis then. Expand this a little bit. What just happened? Okay, there they are. I see them. I'm looking at this pair of stars, the green one and the red one. Appears to be working. Try something else. Just gonna experimenting here, but I want to test. All right. So where I'm doing my checks here. I do that. Oh shit, we figured it out. Like, obviously, there's still some issues here. We figured it out. We figured out the math part and what was wrong there. Now we just have to figure out the dynamic update. of the particle system itself so that we don't have to do this kind of janky swapping of systems. But now, if I do this, should be able to do it without getting a screen full of text. So, like, obviously there's some pop-in here. But it's working. I mean, the theory in math is there. Just gotta figure out the particle update shit. Fun. All right, and now we can go turn the, okay. All right. Okay. I mean, I'll take that. That's a victory. Like, the hardest part is figuring out the math. Figuring out the Niagara stuff will come. I mean, there's going to be a way to do what I want to do, I think. Let's see. So, I want to take this value and up it to something more realistic. See how it'd feel to kind of cruise around. Because, like, it wouldn't be flickering as much. Like this, right? Because it's, like, the bigger it is, the more distance you force the user to go in order to rebase, the less flickering there's going to be. Alright, I want the full experience. How about 100 million? The real deal. Space travel experience. Alright, now, there is more to be done. For one thing, uh, Universe Game Sim. Oh, it is a million. Okay. Million's fine. We need to change the size scaler then? Oh yeah, that's huge. Well, now they're too small to even see. Actually, not necessarily. A million. Save it, compile it. We're gonna cut this. Down. At 80 million. 1, 2, 3. Save. Down to 80 million. The scale. Will have to come up. Do maybe 5,000. We can also to reduce this, we can also increase the brightness of the material. And let's try that. Change. Maybe not. Right, I think. Yeah, that makes them have infinite lives. Oh, no, it doesn't. No, it doesn't. That's right. I'll hit it eventually. No. Shit. Well, now that I figured out that, I kind of want to just undo my walk this back a bit.
Thank you.
Alexa, broadcast.
What's the announcement?
Yeah, give me a minute.
Announcing.
Yeah, give me a minute.
May actually have to review the video to figure out what I broke. But I'm about to go make dinner, so that'll be it for now.